Good morning and welcome to the beautiful Whistler Sliding Centre, nestling in a shady tree-lined valley just outside the town of Whistler in the west of Canada, British Columbia, the westernmost province of this northern country, and bathed in sunshine this morning and with fresh powder all around. The season opening early this year, the ski lifts are open, the gondolas are heading up the mountains, and inside the village there is a definite frisson. On the mountain as well, because it's 4-man day. It's stop three on the Viessmann FIBT World Cup Tour. Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Martin Haven. Alongside me is Canadian slider Helen Upperton. And Helen, back at the 2010 Games track, everybody's just got that little bit of a jingle, I think, this morning.
Yeah, it's very exciting to be back here in Whistler. There's a tremendous legacy from the 2010 Games, and obviously the Canadians really enjoy sliding here, and the community loves watching bobsleigh, so...
Well, this track has a certain reputation, doesn't it? It is the fastest place on the planet, and drivers have to be very aware in these big 4-man sleds.
This is the fastest track in the world. It's 1,450 meters, and it's a very fast start, very steep. The track drops away, and you feel the speed immediately. It's an extremely exciting race, an exciting track to drive.
Well, one of the features, of course, is a corner that was named in the pre-Olympic event 50-50 by Steve Holcomb and the crew. And that is corner 13, perhaps appropriately, I suppose, rather than 10 or 14 or anything it could be. And that's one that the drivers will have to watch out for, because the 50-50 reputation is well earned. Well, let's take a look then at a bobsleigh run down this track with the biggest vertical drop as well early in the run.
Yeah, 152 meter vertical drop, and you can see how steep this start is. We're watching a point of view camera on a sled driven by Andre Lang, German pilot, heading into the first corner known as Slingshot. It's the epitome of the sensation the drivers feel in that corner. Into a small corner three, into a big two pressure corner four. This track has a lot of big sweeping corners in it, and you actually start to feel a speed very early on. Big right hand number seven, known otherwise as Looter's Loop, into a straightaway with a bend in it, corner eight and nine. 10 here sets up Shiver, corner 11 into the bottom of the track. You're going over 130 kilometers an hour at this point in time in the track, into the 50-50, corner 13, through the bottom. Speeds over 140 into Thunderbird, the finish turn. The four-man's fastest four-man clock as it crossed the finish line has been over 150 kilometers an hour.
Which is awesome speed. You know, the track records date back to that 2002 Winter Olympiad, the start record from Andre Langer's four-man crew. And, of course, the Olympic gold medalist Steve Holcomb holds the track record here. Well, air temperature hovering just above freezing, ice to 3 degrees below, and that hopefully shouldn't change much. Controlled steel is what the other runners and the sleds are measured against, so that nobody leaves them on the radiator overnight and melts the ice for everyone else. Well, our top 10 in the World Cup rankings go into a random draw, and it's Nick Cunningham of the USA who will be the first sled on the ice. John Jackson of Great Britain goes off 6th, Stephen Holcomb 7th, and birthday boy Lyndon Rush will be 5th sled off the hill. But Alexander Zubkov, who leads the World Cup rankings, he starts 10th of what is now a 22 sled field, because again, because of injury, Edwin van Kalker and the Dutch will not be sliding.
Good.
So far this season, pilot Good. Nick Cunningham has had an incredible start to his four-man. They've been in the United States on Good. Home track, so we'll see how he handles this Canadian Good. Venue.
He's got Good. Adam Clark, Andreas Drabble, and Christopher Folt behind him. Folt was on the back of the two-man sled yesterday. And they have been really making a big impression, as Helen says. Third in the first race of the season at Lake Placid. And he has not been out of the top six yet this year. Great rookie season. And Handel gets in, 4.81 getaway.
The track record on this track, the push record, is a 4.70. So they're a little bit off the pace. They're 66.7 kilometers an hour after the first turn.
That is over 41 miles an hour, just a couple of hundred meters in. Shows how fast all this muscle can accelerate this sled.
Smooth run so far from Nick Cunningham. along the left wall going into corner nine. You can tell just by how he's driving how confident he is in his steers based on his performances so far. Heading into the 50-50, nice smooth lines, 132.7 kilometers an hour, good speed.
82.5 miles an hour and still accelerating hard. 91.4 as they go into Thunderbird, still picking up speed. This is really very quick indeed. And if you think what the speed of 90 plus miles an hour feels like in your road car in the dry, then do it in one of these high-tech carbon coffins coming down the track on sheet ice, and you can imagine what the sensation is. 4 or 5 times the force of gravity acting on your body in that final corner.
Well, being the first sled down, he set the pace for the rest of the field. Looked like a smooth run. I think Nick Cunningham's pretty happy with that performance.
He looked pretty happy as he stepped out. One of the things that really surprises people, I think, is just how quick this track is. Well, at the top, here's a man who may threaten the start record, Oskars Melbardis of Latvia, former brakeman, just 23 years old still, but started driving after racing in the Olympic Games as a brakeman, and one of the fastest starters we've ever seen.
Yeah, his starts in the two-man are very, very close, if not faster than the push records. We'll see how his four-man crew does here.
Damas Driskins was behind him on the two-man. He's got Arvis Vilkasta and Intars Dandis, another veteran of Latvian sliding.
Look at the size of these athletes as all four of them try to load into the sled as quickly as possible. 4.75. Good push time, fastest push time so far.
May well be the fastest we see. Again, good momentum, 66.7. Cunningham's team had the same. So it's all about how much energy you get into the sled.
So far, small skid.
Tiny margins here we're talking about. He's only 9 hundredths of a second in front.
2 hundredths in the lead so far. Smooth line through 9 and 10 as he heads into the bottom of the track. This is where the speed really starts to pick up. The drivers have to be ahead of their steers. 132.5. A little bit slower than the American team.
Speed's okay. He's a tenth behind, 146.4, so he's, again, half a kilometre an hour back. We're talking about inches at the line. Well, gee, another year of driving, and he is going to be an even bigger threat. You know, he rips off starts like that, Helen, in his big four-man machine. He's going to be very hard to beat if he really can just polish his driving up.
Yeah, he's an incredible athlete, and obviously as he gains experience as a pilot, he's going to continue to improve. The exit of corner one here, nice line, good control. That first corner slingshot is so abrupt, it's actually very challenging to get a four-man through that corner clean and into the straightaway.
Practices his driving at Sigulda in Latvia, which we don't use in the World Cup because it's a little too tight to get a four-man down. You can see him looking...
They're so tired.
Fairly beaten up there.
Yep.
And that's the G-forces, even when he's sitting upright. Well, next up, Germany 1, Manuel Mahata, Christian Friedrich on the sled, Jan Speer and Christian Poser. And Friedrich in for Gregor Birnbach. He's been the alternate so far in the tour, and they decided to let him race this weekend. It was nice of them. Now, he has been down this Whistler track before, though.
Four big men push off the block, head into the track. You want to see a good, smooth load. 487 push time. Let's see their velocity. 66.4, so they're a little bit off the pace.
Mahart, of course, arrived in World Cup bobsled racing with a huge bang. His first ever World Cup performance was here in Whistler. He won a gold medal in the four-man in his first weekend, and was, at the end of the year, the World Cup champion in four-man.
Interesting thing about this pilot is he actually wears glasses underneath his visor as he drives. He's the only person that's ever done that, I think, in the sport.
Yeah, prescription goggles, that would be another interesting kick. 133.9, just to get a few hundreds behind.
But he's picked up some time because of the start. He's now ahead, 147.9, 100th in the lead. It's going to be close as he crosses the line.
Wow, 51.86. There is something about this boy and this track. He really, really gets it in a big way. Manuel Mahata takes the lead. That's very interesting. Didn't feature on the podium in last year's World Cup race. It was a Russian 1-2. Boy, if we see that this year, that'll be a surprise. Great run from Mahata.
Great run to be behind at the start, a bit of a slower velocity. It just goes to show how smooth his drive must have been for him to pick up that much time in the track. You can see all the heads of the brakemen in a row. A little bit uneven, actually, as they're going around that corner. This is the exit of corner 7. Trying to just gently brush that left wall, sending you nice and early into corner 9.
Just imagine the forces that when you're in the back of that sled. It's like being the last car in a roller coaster. That's where all the whip comes from.
All the slush that accumulates on the runners as they go through the braking stretch.
Next up, former Aussie slider Chris Spring had his best ever two-man result yesterday. 27-year-old now lives in Calgary, Alberta. Tim Randall, Adam Rozenki, and Ben Coquel, this year's four-man crew.
We get in and down, trouble with the number 2 guy, 485. That's a 66.5. They're a little bit off the pace. I think it's because their number 2 pusher had a little bit of trouble getting into the sled.
Just a fraction ahead of Manuel Mahata. I'll say that again for Canadian fans. A fraction ahead of Manuel Mahata, a German race leader for Canada 2.
Chris Spring is a good pilot on this track. He's had a lot of runs in the last couple seasons here. He's 200s in the red right now behind the Germans. Smooth run so far.
This is looking really nice. 134.6. That's half a kilometre an hour up on Mahata. This Eurotech sled is flying.
And you see he's pulled ahead. 149.3. Great speed.
Absolutely stunning run from Chris Spring. Wow. The Phoenix really has risen from the flames. This is the sled that was wrecked in that horror crash in Altenburg. They used the frame and rebuilt it with a new cowl. Phoenix, of course.
Yeah.
That was the name for the sled. Wow. How stoked is that?
Yeah, Chris Spring missed the World Cup here in Whistler last year because of that crash in Altenburg, so he's really excited to be back on this track. Look at the power of these athletes as they push off the 50-meter block.
Well, look, we talk about the energy that you put into a sled, and imagine if you're being hit by a 100-meter sprinter at full tilt at 50 meters compared to being hit by a linebacker at the same speed at 50 meters. The amount of energy from the extra weight of the linebacker would make it hurt a lot more. And it's that kind of comparison, you know, you can start the same time but have more energy in the sled somehow. Well, next up, birthday boy Lyndon Rush of Canada. Canada leads with Chris Spring, Canada 2. And Marcellus Brown, Jesse Lumsden, Neville Wright, and their driver Lyndon Rush take the lead here as the snow starts to fall.
This is the first time this combination of push athletes has been in the sled together. Push handle out, and it's in. 4:81 start time. Let's see the velocity. 66.4, that is not a good velocity based on that start time. I think it was because they had a little bit of trouble getting into the sled. The push bar was still out. 600's in the lead right now.
He's got a good move going here. Pulls away a little from Chris Spring, his teammate. 400's up at the start, just adding to that.
Lyndon is the most experienced pilot on this track. He knows it better than anybody else.
Didn't even take the tap from 8 to 9. He just drops straight into corner 9. He's tied for the lead. 134.2. Both Eurotech sleds really posting the high numbers.
Yeah, good speed so far from Lyndon, but losing time to Chris Spring at the bottom. 145.9.
Wow. Well, compared to Spring, 145, Spring was going 149 kilometers an hour.
That sled lost a ton of speed at the bottom of the track.
Incidentally, 146, 90.7 miles an hour. So we're not talking slow compared to fast. We're talking ultra fast.
Watching a replay in the 50-50 is a little bit too high. You can see how high he is at the exit of this corner, driving off, tap on the wall.
Well, that's where it all started to go away, but that means there's something he can tidy up to get quicker in the second heat. A little bit of snow starting to fall. At this stage, it's not going to slow down the start, but another 5 or 10 sleds will be feeling the effects because those grooves you can clearly see, those will fill up with snow, and it just slows you down. John Jackson of Great Britain, Stu Benson, Bruce Tasker, Joel Fearon. That's the four-man crew of GB1. What a season they are having. The Royal Marine Commando, John Jackson, having comfortably his best ever start to a bobsledding year. So just 34 years old.
Great shot of the snow falling at the start of the track. It's one of the only places on this venue that's uncovered.
And this team really keen to get on with this now.
They've had some great push time so far with this four-man crew. You hear the commands exchanged as they head off the block. Smooth load.
Nice low 480s. 482. That is absolutely world class.
66.4. Rushing the wall, heading into three. He has 0.03 of a lead to work with at the top of the track. Jumped into corner five. You saw the back left runner lift off the ice.
Skid there as well. Hemorrhaging away a fraction. Still in the lead as he gets to corner nine.
Into shiver, big two pressure corner with waves. This sets up the bottom of the track, 133.5, so he's slower than both Canadian sleds at the exit corner 11.
See what he can find down through Thunderbird, 148.6 is very good speed. Is he going to be in second place? 0.08 of a second away. That is great drive from Great Britain. Tied with Manuel Mahata. And behind Chris Spring. So the new generations are really stepping up here. John Jackson and the GB crew tied 0.08 off the lead. Fourth place is 0.12 away. Nick Cunningham.
You see a replay here of corner seven, a little bit too high at the exit. He's going to tap on that right wall. Sorry, corner four. You see the sled jump into corner five. We mentioned that earlier in the replay.
Think of the energy. This sled weighs nearly 700 kilos, 1,500 pounds.
Look at the heads all in a row. The aerodynamic of the seating position of the brakeman in four-man is very important. You can see the velocity of the British compared to our leaders, Chris Spring, 148.6, almost 150 kilometers an hour at the bottom of this track.
And look at the snow that gets into the sled from the braking straight, and they've got to clear all that out before they get weighed. Next up, your Olympic champion, Stephen Holcomb, with Justin Olsen, Steve Langton, and Kurt Tomasevich.
This should be the fastest velocity. This crew has pushed together for years. They have a great dynamic, great teamwork. 481 push time, good load. Let's see their velocity out of corner one. 66.6 kilometers an hour with a small tap on the left wall going into corner two.
Should put it into the lead. It does by a few hundredths of a second. Looking for his first four-man win of the season, but he says the night train loves this track.
Gold medal, I would have to agree. And he's coming off of a great two-man race yesterday, so he's very confident, feeling good.
Talking to him just before the start, he said, look, Zubkov's always going to be hard to beat, Lyndon Rush as well. And there are a few more names being thrown in the hat. 135.4, very good speed indeed. Nobody quicker.
149.6, great speed as he comes across the bottom. 900s in the lead.
Wow, 51.66 slide. The night train rolls into the station and one digit goes up, and that's exactly what he wants to see. He knows it is far from over, but that was a good first run. Again, couple of little things to tidy up, but it's almost impossible to be perfect in any drive.
Yeah, Steve Holcomb has lots of great experiences on this track. He really enjoys driving here, especially in four-man.
Wow, look at that. 1,200s behind Chris Spring. Tie for third. Cunningham fifth place. Less than a quarter second back.
Yeah, really close race so far between second and fifth place.
We still have two German sleds, all the Russians to go. Another US sled. It's going to get tight at the top. Next up, Francesco Friedrich, Germany 3. Janis Becker, Gino Gerhardi, and Florian Kunzer are the men on the crew of this young German making his World Cup debut this season. He's just 21 years old. It's a little village of Pirna, just outside of Altenburg. Well, and they're all eager to get going because of the snow.
Yeah, you want to get off that start line as fast as you can in this weather condition. 66.2 kilometers an hour, that's not a very good velocity. 600's behind already. That a lot of that has to do with the load and the push time. These 4-man crews spend so much time practicing how they get into the sled. It's a very small space. Somebody's made the reference that it's like putting four big men in a bathtub together.
Sprinting down the hallway on sheet ice, downhill at breakneck speed. How they ever get in perplexes most people who stand and watch it.
He's losing a bit of time, 132.5 kilometers, and a rough exit from the 50-50. Continuing to lose time, 145.3 kilometers an hour. He's well off the pace.
Well, this is his first ever time on this track. He made his World Cup debut in Samaritz last year, prior to that, only ever raced in Europe. But see, when there's all those fingers held out by the coaches, yeah, whatever. If it's not a one or a two, okay, we'll catch up with that later.
Yeah, this driver's had a great start to the season, especially in two-man with a couple bronze medals.
Yep. First time ever on the podium outside of Europe.
Watching a replay of the 50-50 here, you're going to see him have a late entry. The runners are turned as hard as they can as he tries to, you were calling it Robin Hood maneuver, like pulling the string of a bow back. That's the driver trying to get the sled off the corner as hard and as quickly as he can.
Look, for all its reputation, 13-50-50 looks like a nothing corner. There are lots of big, big corners. 13's just a little on and off. And yet, that's the one that stumbles and everybody trips over.
Yep, the small ones are the hard ones.
Max Arndt with the alternate in the crew, Rennie Tiffert, in place of Gregor Birnbach, having his first race this season, and then Alex Mann and Alex Roedinger.
Good load from the team, 484. Let's see the velocity. That was a smooth load from the crew. 66.3, not fast enough. He'll continue to lose time based on that velocity, 300th behind. Small wave in corner four and a bit too early on to corner five.
They ended up in the bottom.
Just a few hundreds separating all of the sleds here.
A rough line through corner seven.
I tell you what though, he's got speed, just 200ths of a second off the lead of Stephen Holcomb, the Olympic champion.
1100 back, 132.7. Let's see his bottom velocity as he comes around Thunderbird, 147.9. The fastest sled so far we've seen has been over 149 kilometers an hour.
51.96 slide. He's in sixth position, just ahead of Lyndon Rush. Just behind Nick Cunningham. Well, with the snow coming, there will be no break in proceedings. Normally, we'll have a two-minute pause for a TV commercial after the 10th sled before the 11th, but with snow falling at the top of the track, well, you can see there's not an awful lot of it down at the bottom here, and that's not just a few hundred feet down the hill. So, very localized weather here in Whistler.
Yeah, yesterday during the women's race, yesterday evening, it was snowing at the top of the track and raining at the bottom. So, interesting weather conditions indeed at this Whistler venue.
Blue jacket, one of the jury members, Tony Carlino. He's also the track boss at Lake Placid. There's plenty about all sides of the sport. Alexander Zubkov of Russia there. Now, like Stephen Holcomb coming into the two-man race yesterday, undefeated in four-man this season. He's taken two straight wins in America. And looking for one here in Canada as well.
Bit of a practice load from the left side pusher.
Do you know what? You need all the practice you can get, don't you? Zubkov, now 40 years old. Alexei Negadela on two. Dmitry Chernenkov and Maxim Makrusov, the rest of the four-man crew of Russia one.
Good fast load, well in the sled before the crews end at 50 meters, and a very good push time, 480 push time, 66.8. That's the type of velocity you need to challenge for a medal position.
He doesn't worry about being absolutely the fastest. What he wants is the energy in the sled to drive it down into the lead.
500's already in the green, a small mistake going into corner four, but Zubkov drives this track really well. 1300s ahead. He's picking up some time on the rest of the field. I wonder if the confidence of these Russian pilots on this track has improved a little bit now, being coached by Canadian bobsleigh driver Pierre Lemieux, finish fifth in 52 men on the 4-man. 148.7, good speed.
Fantastic speed from the Russian, 51.63. There is Luders. Well, he didn't hold his advantage all the way down midway through. 13 hundredths in front, ended up just 3 hundredths ahead of Holcomb. You don't have to win by much to win. It's not a comfortable margin. Zubkov will have to pull out all the stops in heat two, Helen.
Yeah, he actually had a pretty good margin of a lead at the top of the track. It just goes to show you how good of speed and driving Holcomb had in the bottom of this track, because he lost time to the American sled in the bottom of the track. You're looking at the lines here. Good entry into the Thunderbird. Look at all the heads. This is a great shot of the aerodynamic of a 4-man crew.
Holcomb with great speed, 149.6, full kilometre an hour quicker. It's only a fraction of a mile an hour, but it's enough to knock a tenth out of the Russian's lead. Well, he knows where he needs to tidy up, and undoubtedly he will do so. Top 10 down, Alexander Zubkov, undefeated this year, leads in this World Cup four-man race. Martin Haven and alongside me, Helen Upperton, Canadian slider. Well, this is Russia 2, Alexander Kazyanov. Behind him, Max Belugin, Ivo Kutsin and Nikolai Renkov. And these were the guys that finished in the silver medal position. At least three of them were on the sled in last year's World Cup race here.
See all four of these athletes in and down. Push bars in, 484 start time. Good exit of corner one and a 66.7 kilometer per hour velocity. That's a very good velocity from that start time. You hear the noise of the sled as it rumbles down the track. Smooth drive so far. I think this venue held his best result last season in four-man, so I'm sure he's confident also. Great result so far from his teammate Alexander Zubkov, leading at the bottom. He's 400th ahead with 134.5 kilometer per hour speed out of corner 11.
Quicker than Zubkov, and he has the lead. Is he going to beat his teammate? No, he's slower there. So Zubkov will lead. It'll be Russia 1-2, though. Wow, 51.63 from Zubkov, 51.65 from Kazyanov. That is sensational driving from the Russians.
Yeah, seventh fastest start time, second at the bottom. Another great drive on this Whistler track from this pilot.
Blood on the back of Alexei Negadelo's calves as he's been spiked by his teammates getting in behind.
Comes with the territory for those side pushers when they're trying to load in the sled with those sharp shoes. We're watching a replay here. Corner 11 at the bottom of the track, heading into 12. Bit over the blue line. That's a high exit, but not an overreaction from the pilot to maintain those types of speed in the bottom of the track.
Look, the Russians look so-so at best in two-man, but put them in a four-man, boy, they can drive these tanks down the hill. Next up, Martin Gallagher of Switzerland with Kevin Mitterhuber, Philippe Moser, a late sub, in at three, and Thomas Amrine on the back handles of the Swiss two sled. Now, both Swiss drivers had crashes here in training, so they will be, all the crews, hoping for a comfortable ride down. Snow just abating at the moment, and that's got to be good news for the race.
See the load and the push time from these athletes. They're probably a little bit sore and beaten up from the week of training here. 5:04 start time. The velocity should indicate that push time. They're, a kilometer off, over a kilometer off the fastest velocity heading into the first portion of the track. Already almost half a second behind.
Talking to one of the Swiss brakemen earlier who was crashed in the four-man in the first day of training, and I said, you know, everyone's sitting there, aren't they, counting 8, 9, 10, and they go, please get us through, please get us through, thank you if it happens. And he said, well, you know, all we can do is the first 5 seconds. After that, it's out of our hands.
Big wave in the first pressure of corner 11, 130.4, no problems down here in the bottom of the track. You can definitely tell the difference between the aerodynamic seating position of the top sleds versus, you know, the middle of the field. The brakemen aren't quite sitting in a row.
I tell you what, I think they were all very, very tense, and he got very wild. They're counting, they're getting to 9, they're getting to 10, and suddenly there's all this extra pressure, and you can feel the sled skidding, and you're going, oh, please get us through. Good job, Martin Gallagher.
Yeah, after the week that he had, I think that that's a pretty good performance in the race so far today.
Yeah, absolutely. Get in, get it down.
Seeing the, you can see the sled skidding up with all of the pressure. This is corner 14 in the bottom of the track, corner 15 in the bottom of the track. He lost a lot of time down there, but I think, you know, a little bit of overreacting, a little bit of stress from having a hard week.
You've got to imagine, all very, very tight in these two sleds. Rico Pater, Owen Taylor behind him, originally born in Belfast, Northern Ireland. He's having his first race weekend. There's Kayleigh Humphreys, won yesterday in a women's race. Thomas Roof and Seaman Freely, the rest of the crew. And Owen Taylor's had a couple of days sleeping off a real bang on the head when they crashed in the first run of 4man. Funny to be in with the Swiss bobsleigh crew, hear them all speaking Swiss, and then a Belfast accent comes out. Owen struggling to get in, can't get his legs around the driver. He's still not got his legs around the driver.
Yeah, 494 push time and a lot of trouble with the load, 65.7 kilometers per hour. The fastest pushing teams make that load look real easy, and it is not easy at all.
Big head up there from Rico Pater. He wants to know exactly where he's going. That's a sign that he's not quite confident of the line, not feeling the force yet.
Yeah, half a second back. This is such a hard track to drive with only a few practice runs during the week. Little experience on this technical track. Big hit going into the 50-50 and a rough exit from the 50-50.
Got out with the runners still down, and that's what counts. 145.2, better speed than their teammates as well. They had a quicker start by a tenth, and they come down in 12th place, 52.57. To say, you know, that perhaps the hardest load is to be at two. You're the last guy to get in, and you've got to get your legs around the driver's seat, so quite tough to get down.
Yeah, and look at the how slowly they're all climbing out of the sled.
As Owen gets out from number two, they're in, they're down. Thank you, boss. Good job.
Yeah, high fives all around. Here we go with a hit on the left wall before corner 13. He's going to have a late entry. The sled's going to climb. You're going to see, look at the weight of all the brakemen on the right-hand side of the sled. Articulation helping to keep all those runners down.
Well, there you're in the lap of the gods, really. It's just how far downhill all that weight goes, whether it drags the sled with it or whether somehow your speed carries you through the corner. Yeah. Yes, we're all there. Jürgen Lewacker of Austria is our 14th starter. Stefan Wittholm behind him at two. Marcus Sammer and Sebastian Hoefler. So again, a couple of changes in the Austrian 4man lineup. Bit of snow drifting down in the start area, but not much to worry these teams.
Lowacker usually lacking a bit in start time, but a very experienced pilot in this field. 5.00 push time, this velocity should indicate that start time with 65.4 kilometers per hour. Smooth driving so far from this experienced Austrian pilot, 4/10 back.
Led by Alexander Zubkov. 1-2. The Austrians towards the tail of the field.
We have a late exit of corner 7, but no problems down that bend away. Corner 8 into the bottom of the track. Here we go, heading into the 50-50. 131.3 kilometers per hour. Not a lot of velocity at the bottom here. 146.6 as he comes around Thunderbird.
Could put in top 12, 13th place, just behind Rico Pater, 52.72. Don't forget, two sleds, if all 22 complete the course safely, will be spectators. And at the moment, Martin Gallagher, Switzerland 2, is in 14th spot. Jürgen Lewacker in 13th. They are at the bottom of the pile.
Yeah, 13th fastest push time, 13th at the bottom. Smooth run from this driver, though. You can see the pressure at the exit of corner 11. You see his entry here as he goes into 11. That blue marker helps the pilots know where their height is, where they need to steer, and how they really want to head into that 50-50 curve, especially in a 4man.
Next up, Jan Verber of the Czech Republic, Dominic Suchy, Jans de Klaester and Michal Vacek on the back of the sled. Didn't make the cut in yesterday's two-man race. Really tight-looking run. Six runs in training, and that's split between two and four-man. Tends to be the case that you'll take four runs in the four-man and only two in the two-man. But if you don't get them all down safely, then obviously you lack even more track time.
To see a fast load in and down, push handles in 492.
That's ahead of Luaka and Gallagher, the two teams they need to beat to make the race. 65-6, about in the same margin in terms of the first corner speed.
Marba struggled a little bit yesterday in the two-man competition. Let's see how he does today in the four-man run. Four-man, a heavier sled, a little bit less.
Oh, how did he get out of that?
This same problem happened yesterday in the two-man competition. He lost his back end. He's going to have lost so much time from that mistake in the corner.
And the confidence takes as much of a rattling as the hip bones do, getting slammed into the wall like that. That was the classic Luna's loop, high and low tail. But he gets them down safely, but I don't think they're going to make the second heat. 53.87.
That was the most extreme sideways skid through a corner I've ever seen in four-man in bobsleigh.
I see the guys are more than happy to get out of the sled. Well, that's where Luna's loop got its name, isn't it? From exactly that. Going in forwards, coming out backwards.
Almost.
And, yeah.
We're going to see this again. You can see the nose of the sled gets caught up above the ice in the track. The bottom end drops out. His nose is near the roof. It hit the roof, and that's what sends him back down into the short wall.
Hitting the woodwork at the top of the track actually saved them.
Yeah, you can see the brakeman bounce as the sled hits that concrete wall.
Yeah. Jan, he'll be happy to see Winterberg, I think. Yeah, well, no, luckily not. Yeah.
They almost went out of corner seven facing the wrong direction.
Okay, there's a whole TV truck breathing again now, guys. It's not just the Czechs and their coaches. Well, next up for USA, Corey Butner, sliding to Sochi 2014. Jesse Beckham, Johnny Quinn, and Nicholas Taylor are the USA 3 crew. After that remarkable escape for Jan Verber, has he used up everybody's lives? I don't think we're going to need them here. 4.90, that's a big start for the US crew.
Not a bad start time. A little trouble getting into the sled. 66.0 kilometer per hour velocity heading into corner two. Corey Butner's had a great result so far in the two-man competition. The American program's been really strong so far at the start of the season.
The Californian, of course, there are so many Californians and Hawaiians in bobsleigh. What would there be?
Six tenths of a second back from the leader. A little bit of a high line in the first part of corner 11. Not a bad four-man run from Corey Butner.
12th at the start, slipped down to 14th place at the moment on the split times. If he gets good speed here, and that's not bad, he could pull himself back up into the top dozen. 14th at the line, well, safely makes the second heat, and plenty that he can think about trying to tidy up in the second run. Again, for the crews, not exactly enough fingers to hold out to show you where you are when you're down in the teens.
See the driver looking at the start times, the split times, the velocity, always analyzing the run. Tight race with our top four sleds, 1,500 separating first to fourth place. A tie for third right now.
And a tie for fifth as well. So top six features two ties, all within a quarter of a second. Nick Cunningham, 2,700s behind. He's got to think there might be a chance of a medal on here as well. Well, Canada three now, Justin Cripps with Jean-Nic Carrière, Luc Dimitri and Cody Sorensen on the back of the Canada sled. And there's the girl who won yesterday's women's race at a canter, your teammate Kaylee Humphreys.
Yeah, out to support the men.
Plus, standing under the roof there means she's out of the snow. No flies on her. Now let's see what these guys can do. Low 480s, they really be looking for a big start if they can find one.
Good load from the crew. 492 push time. Not a bad load. We should see the velocity a little bit off the pace with the velocity heading into the second quarter. See the mustache for his November 4-man sled on the front. A bit of an early entry to corner 5. We saw the sled jump into the corner. Obviously, this being a Canadian track, it's one of the tracks where Justin Cripps has the most runs and the most experience. He's a fairly new pilot, raced as a brakeman in the 2010 Olympics here for Pierre Luters. Base in corner 11 and a hit before corner 12. Managed to catch up again, heading into the 50-50. Bottom speed, 146.2 kilometers an hour. Not bad speed, 8/10 off the pace.
That brings him into 13th place, 52.58. And how close is he? 100th behind Rico Pater in 12th position. So a real battle on his hands.
Yeah, you see the push times reflect in the finish time. 13th fastest start, 13th place at the bottom.
Getting out there is Nick Carrière, used to play for Toronto's Argonauts. And the Argos, of course, in the Grey Cup.
You see a very high line here in the bottom of the track. Look at the aerodynamic of all the brakemen. Great sitting position, all in a row. Cody Sorensen usually pushing in Lyndon Rush's 4-man crew. Today, switched pilots, switched teams, pushing for Justin Cripps.
Trying to make sure that all the Canadian teams have the best possible getaway here on this Canadian track. Next up, Simone Battazzo of Italy, Samueli Romanini, Luca Pagin, and Francesco Costa. Follow me if you can. Well, hopefully the three guys behind him will obey those instructions. Wolfgang Stampfer is the former Austrian driver who coaches them. That's him in the green jacket at the back. He built the sled. One thing you always saw about Stampfer sleds is when the speeds got high, they were right up with the very fastest, no matter what the start was like.
Long time to get those push bars in. Heading into corner one, 64.9 kilometers an hour. That is not a good velocity at the top of the track. They're going to continue to lose time. Smooth run so far. Good entry to 6. Tazzo's a very experienced pilot. Grew up driving on the track of Cortina d'Ampezzo in Italy. Very difficult, very challenging track. This must not be that scary for him.
At least he's got ice on the sidewalls. 133.1, not bad velocity. Quicker than a few we've seen recently. He could end up in the top 12 here, getting close.
Good 14th. Bottom speed.
13th. 12, yes it is. And there's Wolfgang Stampfer on the right. I always see a lot of similarities between Battazzo and Stampfer. Not the fastest at the start, but give them enough ice, they can really drive into contention.
Yeah, the Italian team actually used to be one of the more competitive start times, but rebuilding the program after the Torino Olympics in 2006.
148.5 at the bottom, 82.5 miles an hour.
Yeah, picked up a lot of speed at the bottom of the track.
Again, you know, you go to somewhere like St. Moritz where the Stampfer sleds are always one or two through the speed trap at the bottom. Well, next up for Slovakia, Milan Janišek, Martin Tezovic, Vladimir Simic, and Adam Zavacki. And after three crashes in 4 sleds in training a couple of nights ago, these guys spent 25 minutes kicking their heels, trying to stay warm and focused. And Milan, who is an owner-driver, if you like, owner-operator of this sled, came out, took them down nice and clean, no dramas, no mistakes. So it can definitely be done. A little bit more snow at the top.
Time to get going with the snow accumulating in the start of the track.
It's been sliding perhaps as long as anybody else in the business. Started in 1998. Well, the man at 3 slips. Vladimir Simic does get in though, and they load without too much drama.
Big skid out of corner 1. Very important to make sure you have all your crewmen in the sled. Just a close call there with their number 3 pusher.
A valid point. If you come down with a 3-man sled, then it is instant disqualification.
That rule in boxing is that you have to cross the finish line with everything you started with, including the people. 9/10 of a second back. through the corner there. 131.6, very far off the pace with the velocity. Out of corner 11, high line in 15.
Well, he got safely into 50-50, made it a lot more look like a 90-10. He had no dramas there, but he was probably steering a lot to make sure that he got the line that he needed, going for safety rather than speed. 53-01 leaves him in 18th spot, still ahead of Jan Verber of the Czech Republic.
Watch this number three brakeman miss the bunk. His foot slips off the bunk as he's trying to get into the sled. A lot of times you see actually the number four guy help. They grab the suit and try to pull that brakeman in, that crew member into the sled. But very good job from number three to make sure he's in and down.
Well, the first time it was the instep of his foot, which has no spikes, that landed on the bunk. The spunks overshot. High line there, though, Helen.
Yeah, very high. You see the sled sliding sideways off. They're going to hit that right wall. The head's bouncing around in the bottom of the sled.
There is Milan, and got them down safely again. Next up for Korea, this is our 20th starting sled. So after this, the race will be full with two still to go. Yunjun Won, Yunjin Suk, Junglin Yun, and Sik Kim are the guys on this four-man. And this is where the Korean program first surfaced in World Cup action in January, with one two-man sled driven by Yunjun Won and a four-man sled as well. Now he is their representative in World Cup in two and four. They get in 4.95, and that is not a bad getaway from the Koreans. Now, of course, they've done their learning on the tracks in the North American Cup. So Calgary, Whistler, Lake Placid, Park City. And they have a push track in Pyeongchang in Korea, where the 2018 games are. So for them, really, this is their home track so far.
Yeah, they've spent a lot of time over here in North America getting a handle on the driving, getting used to sliding, and now representing their country on the World Cup level. Obviously building their program, because they're hosting not the next Olympics, but the one after in 2018.
31-1, not bad speed. 31.5.
Pretty good run from this Korean. 144.5, so almost 6 kilometers off the pace.
17th, he's in the race, and Jan Verber is 20th, with Martin Galica and Milan Janoszak 18th and 19th. Janoszak will make the race. Beg your pardon, Galica will make the race. Janoszak and Verber, though, for Slovakia and the Czech Republic, are the ones in the drop zone. But the Koreans are in. They will get heat too.
You see some pressure building as the sled's climbing at the exit of 11. You can see the heads in the back of the sled behind the pilot bouncing around. Too early onto corner 12, but no big problems in the bottom of the track from this driver. Under, nice turn under that blue line.
They're sitting up quite high in the sled, aren't they? But again, that will come. So the race is full. No pressure then, obviously, for the remaining two sleds. Both francophone drivers. Speaking French is, of course, Frenchman Loic Costergue, Roman Einrich, his two-man brakeman, Ivan Ivanitsi, and Florent Ribet are the four-man crew of France 1. And their target now is to get down within a minute and a half of the leaders to guarantee a second heat. Just avoids the short wall there, 5.09 start.
Yeah, a bit of a problem getting into the sled, headed towards that left wall, and a very hard turn in corner 2. Again, an inexperienced pilot, only 6 runs of training split between 2-man and 4-man. It's not a very easy way to enter a race.
He's been sliding since 2009, so this is 3rd year on ice. He's already in France's World Cup squad. 1.2 back in 21st place so far.
See, at the bottom of the track as the speed starts to pick up. Waves in corner 11, a bit too early onto corner 12.
This is to get it under control. Hauls it off 13. 129.2. It's not about the speed. It's about not breaking up the crew before they get to Europe. Tracks they know a little better. And a 53.91. Bruno Mijon there on the left-hand side is the coach. Well,
pilot's shaking his head, but the relief on the coach's face is that everybody's safe and down to the bottom of the track.
And you know as a driver, don't you? You are responsible for the crew, whether you're racing in your two-man or whether you're driving a taxi bob down with guests behind you. You are responsible, and they feel that.
Yeah, you're going to see this entry into the 50-50 here. Late height, sled climbing towards the exit of the corner. You run out of track. You can see the runners turn and the articulation flexing as the sled tries to come down. Pretty good reaction from the driver, though. No panicking. Pretty good control.
There is Loic. Gets down, gets points. It all adds up, and there's no injuries. Crashes in practice for Belgium's Michael Cerise in the fairly decent conditions in practice. Sébastien Thuillet, Lino van Doorn, and Mikael Ditsuta are the crew.
Yep.
And there is a, like for the others who crashed in training, Helen, you know, when you've got that behind you, you want to try and make sure it doesn't get back in your mind and haunt you when you're racing.
Yeah, obviously the racing environment, the track is usually a little bit faster. All the crews in bring less protection, just the spandex suits, often burn vests. You have to definitely try to put it in the past, focus on what's coming ahead. The bobsleigh run is so quick, you always have to be thinking one corner ahead. 64.9 kilometers an hour. The fastest velocity we've seen so far at the push has been 66 kilometers an hour at the start.
Now, Julian Verbe in 20th place, bearing in mind what a close shave he had in the first heat. You're watching this with mixed emotion, wondering, well, normally you want them to go behind you, but actually, do you really want a second run here?
A bit of a big hit before corner 11, big waves. He's losing control of the sled.
Needs to get it off here and just manages to haul it off. Yes, he knew he was in danger. All the focus there is on getting everybody down safely. It's a rocky ride for the crew, but they get it done. And down, and he is in the race. Oh, they're going to have to go again. I'm not sure whether that will please the brakemen or not. I would think perhaps Jan Verber's crew may be a little relieved.
One of the things that saved him in that 50-50 is that he'd lost some speed from some huge mistakes through corner 11 and 12, actually. You kill the speed when you're oversteering and skidding around, and he was actually going through the 50-50 a little bit slower. You see how huge that second pressure is at the exit of Shiver. They hit the right wall, pushing them away from the entry of corner 12, and this is where the problems start to compile. The back end of the sled lifting as he enters corner 12, and you can see here the sled climbing at the exit of 13. He's not actually turning the runners that hard. There's no panic in his steer. Good save from the Belgium team.
Roman Heinrich there, the French brakeman, going to offer his congratulations, stroke commiserations. Well done, you're in. Jan Verber and Loic Costaigne for the Czech Republic and France. They are 21st and 22nd. They will not get a second run, but the Belgians definitely do. You can join Helen Upperton and myself for second run coverage live from the Olympic Sliding Centre here in Whistler just after about 40 minutes. Alexander Zubkov is our race leader by the massive margin of 0.02 of a second over teammate Alexander Kazyanov. A further hundredth back, Steve Holcomb lies third, Chris Spring fourth. Manuel Mahata and John Jackson are tied for fifth position. We could be in for a very, very exciting second heat. Well, no dramas, but a couple of upsets, perhaps, in terms of performance in the first heat. Lyndon Rush, the birthday boy, down in ninth position in our top 10 rankings. But Helen, anybody from seventh up has got to be thinking medals, definitely there to be grabbed. And below that, well, again, some very close battles going on. Michael Cerise rounds out the top 20. And it will be the Czechs and the French who watch from the sidelines. No start for Edwin van Kalken through injury. Same for Heath Spence, the Aussie, saw him up at the top. Only had three healthy guys, so that does not make a four-man crew. He couldn't enter the race either. There are the women's bobsleigh racers from the USA. Everybody waiting with bated breath for the second heat of World Cup number 3 for the four-man. We'll bring you all that action live from Whistler. Stay with us for more.